All right. Oh, gotta give me some sweet tea. Ah, cheers. What is up, guys? Welcome back to the TB Drifting YouTube channel. Thank you so much for tuning in. If this is your first time on the channel, be sure and hit that subscribe button and the bell icon so you're notified anytime something comes up on the channel. Today is going to be a great day because guess what? We're back. We have been gone for a little while and I will be sure and tell you why at the end of this video. So be sure and stay tuned to the end so you know exactly what has been going on, why we have not been uploading, and all that great stuff, so don't miss it. But in this video, we have received a couple of things over the past couple of weeks and the past couple of days, and we're getting geared up for this season, so I wanted to go ahead and get one of these things unboxed so that you guys kind of know what we're working with this season. So one of the things that we have received this year is in this box right here. And this is going to be a game changer for us this year, as well as any other Pro-Am driver that will be driving, whether it be East 10 or whether it be out in California. But it's something that is being mandated throughout all of the Pro-Am series. I did think that this would come into play for a Pro-Am organization, but it is. And I'm sure most of you all know by now what this is. It's a Hans device. Huge shout out to Drift HQ for coming in clutch, shipping us this Hans device. We will be partnering with them this year, and that is one thing that I want to discuss at the end of this video is who we have partnered up with this year. But Drift HQ has jumped on board, and they have been gracious enough to send us this Hans device. If you guys know and have researched these devices, you know that there are multiple brands that create these SFI/FIA branded neck restraints, and one of the competitors that I was looking at was the Next Gen. And the reason why I chose the Hans over the Next Gen, first of all, Hans has the name. I mean, they've been in it forever with this simple design, and it's been proven in the past years that they have what it takes to do this. So also with the Next Gen, whether it's true or not, I did see a lot of reviews on that. That specific device tends to fall back for some reason behind you and between you and the seat. So I didn't want that to happen. I've read so many reviews, and Hans is the way to go if you're looking to get into it. The price point is about the same for both of them. I believe the Next Gen was about $50 more than this Hans device, but overall I'm pretty stoked with my decision, and I think this is going to be the best thing for us at this moment. But we're going to go ahead and unbox this thing, and we're going to throw the anchor points on the helmet and then mount it all up to see how it looks. Of course, if you guys know me, you know I've already been in this box, so I've already taken it out of the bubble wrap. But here is the basic device that you get from Hans, and it will already come assembled. Padding will already be velcroed on, the tether will already be put through. The only thing that we're gonna have to do is stick these little Allen bolts and the little clips into our helmet. So that's what we're going to be doing. But overall, the quality of this just looks, it's so simple, but it's so effective. And I guess, put it on here. The way that this works, if I've read correctly, is the shoulder belts will go over this and it'll pull it close to your body. So as long as your belts are tight, it's tight to you, which means that the back cannot move forward as your neck moves forward because it's pushing against your chest. So a lot of people will say that that is one downfall of this one, is it has these pieces that go over your chest. And they say if you are in a head-on collision or you hit something hard enough for it to lash you forward, you can end up with some bruising on your chest. But I mean, that may be some old reviews that I've read, and it could be a little bit different now. So we're gonna try it. This is, like I said, one of the best names out there for these kind of devices, and we just went with it, so we'll see how it goes. They come in different sizes. I went with a medium. I did measure my neck. It goes by neck size, and it's a pretty wide range if you get small, medium, large, or extra large, I believe they offer. But I was kind of in the middle between a large and a medium. but it looked like the medium was gonna fit me a little bit better, so I went ahead and went with that. It's a very simple design, like I said, and if you pull the padding off here, you can see that it has the SFI marking on it that shows you the date that you got it, I guess, or the date that it was manufactured. So mine is very current, and I believe, if I remember correctly, SFI things have 5 years before they go out. So there's that. Now what's in our little baggie here is we got us a sticker we can stick inside the car so that it can be seen by the GoPro footage. Looks like we have an instruction manual, and it goes through and tells you kind of what it does, what the tether straps are supposed to look like, where to mount it, and how to disassemble it if you need to. Also, we have the mounting points, and it did come with a small little wrench for these mounting points and a Allen wrench. So the next thing we are going to do is tackle putting these on. So we're gonna grab our helmet. Got our helmet here. And one thing I was worried about whenever I was purchasing these was if this was universal, but it seems to be that these are universal as long as your helmet has these little plugs where the Hans device thing goes. So we're gonna go ahead and pop these off. And yeah, they've got some things in there. We're gonna read the instructions because this is gonna be our first time and I do not want to screw this up. So as you can see, we have our little holes here. That's what we are going to mount these to. So we'll go ahead and put this one on here. Just hand tighten it here. We will put that up like that. Go ahead and hand tighten it here. So let's loosen this a little bit. We have to turn this little guy right here so that it's facing rearwards. And then go through and tighten. And we'll call that good. Get this out. So I think that is kind of what locks it there. It's kind of a spring-loaded thing here. So I'm guessing that this snaps in here like so. And then it's locked. There's one side. Now we gotta do the other side. Don't know if you can see that, but that has an L on it. So I'm assuming that this is the left one. I did not know that they were marked left and right, but luckily we got it on the right one. So we'll go ahead and put this one in here and snug it down, just like we did the other one. Now that one's done. So now we have our Hans device, and we can go ahead and attach both anchors, or we can attach both ends of the tether to this. Go ahead and snap that one in. Go ahead and snap that one in. And now we're hooked up. I'm gonna try this thing on. So now that we have this thing put together, we're gonna go ahead and test fit it on and see what it's like. So put that on first. It'll take a little bit to get used to this, I know, but. And put our helmet on. So now we have our Hans device on, and you can see that once I have my belts on, it's going to push this as close to my chest as possible. It does limit my head movement backwards, but no more than what the seat would have done. So basically what it's gonna do is push back on this as tight as the belts are, and then if I ever hit something head on, it's gonna be, that's all the movement that I have right there. And it'll be much, much better than that once they're actually fastened to my chest by the seatbelt. It will limit the movement forward. So overall, I think it, like I said before, it's a pretty simple device, but it's been proven to work. And then this right here allows you to turn your head back and forth So you can see it pulls it through here. The one thing that I could see causing an issue with this would be the fact that it's right on my neck. So any movements that I do, it's obviously going to rub my neck raw after so long in the car. But my race suit actually kind of has a collar right here, so it might limit how much this actually touches my neck. So that could be a great thing too. With a t-shirt on, you can see that it's all up on my neck, which if I would have gotten a larger size, it would have been a little bit more off my neck, but I wouldn't feel as supported as I do with this one. So I think this size will be perfect. So here's our setup for this year. We've got a Hans with an HJC helmet, and yeah, I think it's gonna be a great setup. I am so happy that Drift HQ was on board and shot us over this Hans device, and I'm excited to use it. We actually have a drift event this Saturday, and I'm probably going to try and use it. I know that it's made for a 2-inch belt over your shoulders, but I believe you can actually use a 3-inch belt. It'll just have to fold up a little bit right here. At least that's what the instructions say, that it can hold a 3-inch belt, but it's specifically designed for a 2-inch. That's why it has this, and that's why it's so slim right here. As promised at the beginning of this video, I told you that I was going to go through kind of what has been going on and why we haven't been doing any videos lately. So as most of you guys know, if you have competed in Pro-Am stuff, that stuff is so expensive. And there has been so much going on at the end of last year with my job, things with the car, just stuff that we had to take care of. And I got a late jump on my sponsorship proposal / deck. I spent numerous hours on the phone with Nate Hamilton. Shout out to Nate for coming through and helping me one-on-one with my proposal and trying to make it better for our sponsors. But the main thing was I had a hard drive that I saved my previous proposal on, and that hard drive crashed. So not only was that on there, but all of my wedding photos, all of my wedding video from the vlog, all of that raw footage and everything that I've ever created in Photoshop, Illustrator, everything was gone. So I was trying to work with that for months, trying to see if I was going to be able to recover that data or if I just chalked it off as a loss. After reaching out to a company on trying to recover all of that data, it was kind of a gray area as to how much they were going to charge to do it. Of course, I followed some DIY stuff, like sticking it in the freezer for a little bit and then trying it, but it didn't help. I tried plugging it in, unplugging it, plugging it in. It would read for a little bit, but not for long to where you pull data off of it. So long story short, they told me that they couldn't tell me right then how much it was going to cost. It was going to cost $300 just to get it in the facility for them to check it out. And then from there, it could run a bill up to $4,500 or beyond, depending on how long it took them to get in this little hard drive and pull all of my stuff out of it. And that was even if they could pull anything out of it, or heck, they could charge me $4,500 and pull 6 pictures and 3 videos out of it. We don't know, but it wasn't something that I was wanting to dump money into. So we kind of put it on the back burner, and I would just occasionally plug it in and see if it would work. And it read, but it wouldn't read very long, and it would freeze up, and the computer would just completely shut down. So that was our biggest dilemma, was if I was going to have to create something new. And what I thought was, if I'm going to create something new, I'm going to create something new. I'm not going to go back and recreate what I had. So that's why I reached out to Nate Hamilton. And I sent him the previous proposal because I had it saved on my phone. But I sent that to him, and he said, these are some things we need to change. So we went through and changed them. I revamped the whole thing, and we came out with a pretty decent proposal. The only thing was, it was late. It wasn't until January that we came out with this proposal. Normally, if you're trying to get sponsors for any kind of event, you want to go to them at the end of the year where they're trying to get rid of some money for tax purposes, or that's whenever they start looking for sponsorship stuff, or you know, when they're trying to help people out and stuff if they want to. So that's the best time to go to them. I was late. It's my fault, I know, but I've been stressed out since all of that, and it really took its toll on me. I stopped videoing, I stopped doing everything. I was stressed. I was working day in, day out trying to find sponsors for this year, And it came to the point where I said that I wasn't going to be able to do anything this year for Pro-Am. But I didn't want to have to say that because we were so close to getting our Pro 2 license last year. And for us to be so close being our first year, we can only get better because we had no competition experience at all. And now that we do and we know how everything's going to work, we kind of feel more confident coming into the season, not as far as seat time goes, but as far as knowing what's going on, when to be at the line, how long we have until this happens, you know, stuff like that. So we're really confident going into this season with a nice fourth place finish from last year, barely missing that Pro 2 license, but we wanted to do it again this year just to keep that momentum going. We were at the point where we were just going to call it, and we were going to say whatever money we can come up with, we're going to go do one of these Clutch Kickers events and see if we can win some money, and then possibly do some more of them and just win money this year instead of do the Pro-Am thing. But my heart's in the Pro-Am thing. I really want to get this Pro 2 license and start living my dream and competing professionally. So hopefully this year works out for us. I'm feeling really confident going into the season, and we are just a month away from being in the car ready for round one. And I want to thank East 10 for allowing us to drive at these events, hosting these events and everything. So thank you, East 10 Drift, for that. But I think that's gonna do it for this video, guys. Sorry if it was kind of long and rambly, but I wanted you guys to know that I'm sorry for not putting out content. It's just been so busy lately. And then with this sponsorship thing, it's been killing me. So I really haven't been able to jump on the sim lately or do anything to the car just because we weren't sure where we were gonna be. But now that we've got a plan, we will try and bring out some more videos. Anyway, like I said, sorry for the rambling video here, but I just wanted to kind of give you guys a heads up of what is to come and also give you a massive, massive apology for not releasing videos every week like I was before. So hopefully you guys can forgive me and keep joining me for this journey that we have this year. And we're going to get that Pro 2 license, and I'm glad that you guys are watching and you're on board with us every event. So I really appreciate you guys watching. Be sure and stick around the channel for some new videos for the Pro-Am events and any seat time that we get. Be sure and hit that subscribe button if you haven't already, and hit the bell icon. And until next time, we'll see you.